Hey folks, welcome back to the Math Teacher Lounge. I'm Dan Meyer.
And I'm Bethany Lockhart Johnson. We have been talking about this idea of getting rid of this notion of mistakes, of misconceptions. We want to help shift the conversation in classrooms from mistakes to this idea that even if an answer is so-called wrong, it can be brilliant. Today we are talking with Megan Franke. I see her at conferences and like chase after her, and she doesn't run away too fast. I'm so honored that you are joining us on the Math Teacher Lounge, Megan Franke. And would you introduce yourself to the Math Teacher Lounge audience?
Absolutely. First, I just really want to thank you, Bethany and Dan, for inviting me to the lounge, and say back to you both that I'm privileged to learn from both of you, each of you, regularly. So thanks for having me. I am a professor at UCLA, and I study the teaching and learning of mathematics and professional development. I'm really particularly interested in, you know, how do we meet the needs of young people who are the folks who are mostly, almost always marginalized? And those might be because of historic structural racism around Blackness. It could be because they're transgender. It could be because they think differently than everybody else. And that I'm trying to think about how do teachers and we collaborate to try and figure out how to push back on the structures in ways that enable us to support young people, every single one of them.
There's this idea, I think, in math class more than other disciplines that answers and thinking is either right or it's wrong. And if it's wrong, we as teachers, our role is to fix it, to correct that in some way. That feels prevalent because a lot of us learned that way and then became teachers and we teach how we were taught oftentimes. Can you offer the viewers, the listeners, how do you think about student thinking? What are other ways that we can think about how students think?
For me, one of the really critical features is rather than focusing on what students can't do, because we can't really help them with the not what you can't do, we can help them with what are you already doing that's productive and thoughtful and smart, and how do we find that and then leverage that to help them develop further and further, right? The other thing that's really important to us is that within wrong and right, there's so much interesting, powerful mathematics that you both know that happens that gets ignored. And then we say you couldn't do it when actually within what you couldn't do, it was really smart things, right? Really interesting, simple examples of that have to do with if you think about young people, preschool young people who are counting and they count and they get to the 20s and they say 2010, 2011, 2012, and you say, oh, wrong. Wrong, right? You gotta fix that, right? Well, saying 2010 tells you something, they know something really powerful about the mathematics and the way the number system works. And so I can either say, oop, that was wrong, or I can recognize a really smart mathematical idea. So forget the check marks on the page that show all the things that were wrong and give it back, circle the things that you saw that were really interesting that young people could do.
I love even just that shift of just acknowledging the way you're describing the brilliance of what a student is doing and that beautiful tension of like, but wait, what does mastery even mean? Can you talk a little bit about that word and the way that you kind of see it playing out?
If you master addition and subtraction, you can move on and do other mathematical work, but you can't move on until you've mastered that, right?
Yes.
And so what it does is it sorts students between who's mastered and who's not. And it keeps young people like this young person who may have said 2010 from being able to do more interesting mathematics because we say, oh, we got to practice the number sequence first. We can't let you solve any problems that go into the 20s. We can't let you, when actually letting you go farther is going to let you explore that idea of the number system better than if I stopped you. So this idea of mastery gets us in some trouble because it keeps young people from exploring their mathematical ideas.
That's such a huge distinction. And in this moment with COVID and the pandemic, something I keep hearing districts try to address is this fear of learning loss. And I'm wondering if you can speak to that. If this idea that, again, you want, there's certain things, certain benchmarks that you want your students to achieve. But then on the flip side, how can we as teachers not have this more deficit model that we're kind of sending our kids off into the next grade with? Or is that just going to happen? I would love to hear your perspective on that.
Such a great question, Bethany. I'm not sure I have a great answer to it, but I've been thinking a lot about what you're asking. And I am not particularly enamored with the learning loss idea. I think that it is true. We have some great inequities in the opportunities that young people in our country are having right now to engage in schooling. And I think we have to think about that and work on it and figure out what to do about it. But I also think that there are amazing things that young people are learning during this pandemic. And they are mathematical as well. They are having the opportunity to be with family members in new kinds of ways and do different kinds of things together. They're having opportunities to use technology or go on walks or do things that are things, do puzzles that they didn't get to do. And so, and I think that we have this deficit notion of families and we say, oh, you know, if you live in this community and you have this kind of income, you're really at a deficit because your family can't help you. And I think what we would see if we look closely is that families are doing amazing things with their young people and that there's some really wonderful learning that's happening for young people. So we have to balance that. I will also say if you all spend time on Zoom calls with young people, it may not be that the standards are playing out exactly the way we want, but their ability to engage in sense-making, to ask questions, to figure things out, for me, watching it's phenomenal.
Well, Megan, thanks so much for joining us here in the lounge. For folks, for listeners who are hearing all these ideas about ideas and feeling like it involves a very large shift in beliefs, I really appreciate what Megan said about just circle the ideas that are right on a piece of paper. And, you know, I just think about the teacher that I am now interested in ideas versus interested in correctness early on. Like, there was a transition that took time and exercises of the sort that Megan's talking about. And so I'm really grateful for the big picture and the small picture, all the above, and grateful for that these transformations are both personal and professional, that what you're talking about, that generosity towards students, I think it involves a generosity towards people in general. It's just really special. So thank you so much for coming to the lounge, and thank you all for joining us as well.
If folks want to read more about your work or want to engage in these ideas more, where should they turn?
I want to invite folks to come to Twitter, you all. I think that there's just, it's not me, it's the community of Twitter that is just such a wonderful resource for folks who are thinking about these ideas. So I'm on there at Megan L. Franke. There are so many of my colleagues who are doing this work as well. Please come join us in a conversation.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. And thank you for helping us to recognize the brilliance of young people.